Most Fire Emblem characters pretend they're getting paid for their service, when in reality, they're basically doing all this fighting for the Lord's sake pro bono. For the most part in Fire Emblem, hiring allies or even mercenaries themselves don't often have a cost. We don't need to worry about Roy paying someone like Trek or Noah, the game is gonna take care of their wages. That being said, there are a handful of characters that won't be so charitable, that will literally want you to pay up for their service. In this video, we're going to take a look at these particular characters, what their background is, why they're here, and how they get recruited, and what happens when you choose to pay up. Some of these are pretty interesting, to say the least. And at the end, we'll have some nods to characters that cost a little something different than just gold to recruit, let's just say. Jumping right into it, let's talk about Beowulf. Yes, Beowulf, the mercenary for hire that started it all. In fact, this video can pretty much just be the Fire Emblem Beowulf archetype video. Beowulf is a mercenary from Connaught, and together with his buddy Waltz, they're protecting Amphony Castle under Macbeth's orders. Neither like the guy, but only one of them is willing to consider other options. In Chapter 2, he can be enlisted to Sigurd's army for 10,000 gold. While Chapter 2 and 10,000 gold might be kinda crazy high money to spend, this game offers tons of ways to earn money, namely arena grinding and protecting villages. So it might be a hefty sum for someone like Beowulf, but for our team, it's not much you can't make back in about 2 seconds. And voila, Fire Emblem's first actual mercenary for hire. It's also noteworthy that him and Waltz have a special boss conversation. It's short, but it has the right idea. Beowulf and Waltz know the mercenary lifestyle. It's cold and cruel, and everyone knows that money talks. You can be friends one day and enemies the next, and that's just the way it is. And unsurprisingly, Beowulf is the quintessential Beowulf archetype. Cool, cavalier, has a whatever happens, happens sort of attitude. As far as stats go, his stats and class are really solid and he's immediately useful to Sigurd's army. He also makes a great dad, and also has some cool implications with the Beo sword in that Fergus and Diarmuid can wield it in FE5, which has implications about their relationship with the Gen 1ers of FE4. The other characters in this list certainly expand on this archetype, either in characterization of their recruitment, or its mechanical complexity, or both. Let's continue. Farina. In Blazing Sword, Farina is the third and final Pegasus sister you can recruit. So not only does she fit the palace slot in the Pegasus Triangle, but she is indeed this game's Beowulf too. Being from Ilia, a historically shit-ass place to grow up in because it's so cold that agriculture sucks like half the time and the only good way to make money there is to become a mercenary. This girl naturally wants to cash in. It certainly reflects on her personality too. Money is always on her mind. Farina can be recruited exclusively in Hector mode in Chapter 25. All you need to do is wait for her to approach Hector. But instead of paying 10,000 gold, enlisting her service is gonna cost a hefty 20k. If you choose not to recruit her, she stays an NPC unit. She won't even talk to her sisters either. But the question is she worth the buy? If you're doing a ranked run, maybe not, as she's going to negatively affect your funds rank. But otherwise, you ought to have decent gold in your barracks if you are being frugal. She's a decent flyer with A rank and lances, and is available for promotion right out the gate. There is also an Elysian whip in the village on the same chapter. As far as characterization goes, she has really fun supports with Dart and Carla, being really fixated on getting her bag, or treasure. It's cool to see a Fire Emblem character be so fixated on stuff like back pay, hazard pay, negotiating contracts, and that kind of thing. Maybe you can get back pay. We should go in there and both negotiate our contracts. Maybe our combined efforts will inspire him to give us a special bonus. Oh yeah, hey Carla, do you want to be a mercenary with me? We'd be strong and beautiful. Who could resist hiring us? And we could split the payment, 60-40? Rinnock. Rinnock is a goofy character. He's a sarcastic and lazy rogue hired by La Rochelle. He doesn't really like working hard and is kind of miffed that he's being underpaid by the princess. La Rochelle thinks that his devotion to her and her own goodwill is enough compensation. Rinnock often thinks he's plagued with misfortune, but oftentimes he does it to himself. Or at the very least, he doesn't really have an issue with things revolving around La Rochelle. He's first seen trying to keep up with La Rochelle and Dazla, advising her that she ought not to engage herself against the monsters fighting Erica's team. In both chapter 11s of both routes, La Rochelle will appear again, highlighting both times that Rinnock is missing from the party, but she isn't really worried about where he could be. Turns out, Rinnock is trying to get his own bag. In Erica's route, he'll be in Johanna trying to loot treasure in chapter 14, while in Ephraim's route, doing the same thing, looting Renee Castle. This is where you can finally recruit him, and honestly, he's great. In both routes, if you speak to him with the Lord, he'll make a case for his service and offers a weird amount of 9,980 gold, but if you recruit him with La Rochelle in either route... No, I'm no servant like that kook Dazla. I'm a mercenary. I escorted you to Renee like I was hired to do, didn't I? You have no right to drag me across creation without any pay whatsoever. Is this about wages? I believe you've received ample compensation. Ample? Do you even know what that word means? You're the Princess of Rosten. I thought working for you would pay well, yet your purse strings are knotted tight, and I've almost been killed so many. The joy that comes from doing good is not something that can be purchased. There, all better? Let's go. No! I said I don't want to! Riding with you is... And there she goes. Oh, by the stones. Why did I ever take that job in the first place? We must hurry, Rinnock. Right, I'm coming. La Rochelle, bless her heart, is sort of an airhead, but Rinnock, well, he's kind of a pushover. Or he just has a soft spot for her. And voila. Instead of paying just shy of 10,000 gold, La Rochelle persuades Rinnock for free, by sort of... not listening to him until he caves. Hugh. Finishing off the triad of GBA characters that cost gold to recruit, we have Hugh, who has more depth to his recruitment than simply giving a lump sum of money to them. Hugh is an Ilian mercenary, like Farina, hired by the Etrurian army to fight Roy's forces. But, concerned about the loyalty over his bosses that they won't pay him, he asks Roy if he'd like to hire him instead. Hugh is desperate for cash, and claims he needs it to buy medicine for his sick grandmother, who is Nime, which makes this a lie. In all previous cases mentioned already, you just gave a single lump sum of money and there you go. But Hugh gives you options. Here's the deal. His initial asking price is 10,000, but you can refuse this initial amount. If you do so, Hugh desperately asks again, lowering his price to 8,000. If you refuse a second time, he offers 6,000. And if you refuse again, he offers 5,000. Anything less and he gives up and stays an enemy. Every time you swindle, he'll lose a point in each stat. And at 5,000, because you are paying the fourth and final offer, all of his stats drop by 4. Clearly meaning that if you want to actually use Hugh, pay the man he's worth. Generally, people think Hugh is a decent fighter. He's got decent bases, but kinda shitty growths, a good level to promote and gain sage bonuses, and also comes with the members card. His staff rank being E can be pretty painful though, and he'll be outclassed in the healing department by like everybody. Personally, I never used him anyway. Lou and Lilina were plenty fine on their own, and as a staff user, he's pretty garbage. You could just steal the member card and leave him be, or kill him if you're truly evil. Volk. Volk is a pretty important character to Ike's personal growth. He starts out as a thief who will join your party, but will charge 50 gold per chest and door he opens. He's quite the mysterious guy and has a connection to Grail and Ike somehow. He joins the party in chapter 10, kinda popping in from a hallway asking about Grail's whereabouts. When Ike tells him that Grail was killed, he is quote unquote surprised, but continues to talk about his supposed intel he has for him. When Ike asks what this intel is for, he says he'll tell for 50,000 gold, which Ike remarks is steep. As Volk is about to leave, Soren interjects and advises that picking locks and chests would likely be less dangerous than trying to steal keys from guards, especially given the context of this specific chapter. Ike can hire him for his service, or not, but assuming you do, he'll charge 50 gold per. In chapter 19, when Ike is now promoted into a lord, commander of Crimea's forces, and basically the big cheese now, Volk returns. Whether or not you hired him in chapter 10, he offers his intel again, same price and all. Ike decides to pay him. So, interestingly, Ike gains this story-only 50,000 gold by raiding a Daeon fortress and claiming its spoils. So this money isn't even in-game. Now, I'm about to get into some major Path of Radiance spoilers, so you are warned. If you don't care about this, skip to here. There was never intel prepared for Grail to begin with. While Volk pretended to be surprised of Grail's untimely death, it is most likely he already knew Grail was killed. Volk tells him that Grail literally hired Volk to kill him if he so happened to ever touch the medallion again. This would mean that Volk would always have to be near Ike's family at all times. Not only that, but previously, Volk told Ike that he can ask any barkeep about the fireman, and Volk himself would be at his side in no time. You could only pull that stunt if you were trailing your target forever. And last, Volk also admits that Grail explicitly told him to wait until Ike was mature enough to handle the truth. And it kinda makes sense that Ike being the commander of an army is now an opportune time to reveal that truth. Volk tells him about Grail, his mother, and the medallion. Ike can then choose to rehire Volk, this time as an assassin. He takes part of the 50k you saved up as payment. And voila, an assassin joins the team. The funny thing is, if you decline his offer to rehire, or he was already KO'd before this, he kinda just leaves, with that 50,000 story gold still in his hands. Volk is a full-blown assassin in Radiant Dawn, and he's available in 4-5 to recruit. This time, however, his old partner Bastion, or Queen Alencia, can recruit him for a paltry 3,000 gold. When Bastion asks why so little, he says to consider it a discount rate, since he especially has a bone to pick with Izuka. He'll also piece the hell right out of the battlefield completely if you somehow don't have 3,000 gold on you. Despite being easily the highest profile for hire character in this list, he's the cheapest to hire. Shura, from Fates. Shura's fate, no pun intended, in Conquest is famous for the choice you need to make between sparing him or executing him. Shura had to rely on banditry because his home, Koga, was invaded by the neighboring Mokushu, destroyed by Kotaro, and Hoshido wouldn't let him live there, so he had to try to survive in Nor. In chapter 16, he's leading his band of thieves disguised as a Norian soldier, but once he's defeated, his motivations become revealed. He wants vengeance and thought that plundering this ship and gaining the spoils would buff up his chances to actually succeed amidst the chaos of war. He also reveals that he's always felt bad for being the one commissioned by Yukimura to kidnap Azura from Nor and wants to make amends by protecting her this time. Korin is to make the choice. Sparing him allows him to fight alongside you, and he's quite a good unit. He's got decent bases, a good personal skill, and his bow rank will be helpful against the Ninja Hell in the next chapter. But at what cost? A pair of boots. If you kill Shura, you get boots instead. Boots are valuable, so while it doesn't cost gold explicitly, it is more valuable than 8,000 or 10,000 gold. And personally, it's up in the air for what you need. Like I said, Shura is very solid and as an outlaw already provides a movement boost when he's paired up and can immediately be useful in chapter 17. But if you're deeply invested in Niles or Mozu or anyone else like that and don't need his reclass options, get the boots, I guess. The mechanic of chapter 16 Conquest is pretty interesting. You have a lump sum of 10,000 gold gifted by Yago that for every turn will lose 300 gold from that pot. It's kind of an interesting take on the 10,000 gold cost of recruiting a character. So it's kind of a, Beowulf archetype recruitment alongside the exchange of boots or a character. Pretty interesting stuff if you ask me. With all this being said, I do enjoy using Shura. He has a decent enough backstory, and his lines in Chapter 16 are well done. He has a special dialogue with Kotaro too. He's one of the few characters that don't initially have a tie to any nation. Shura feels the closest to a Navarre in this game, while also serving as the game's Beowulf too. If the offer was boots or a character way less good, like Revelation Nyx, then the choice would be simple. But what about you? What do you think of Shura? Did you kill him for the boots, or did you keep him? Beowulf is a very good unit. Hugh might not be that great relative to his mage counterparts, but he has the member card, and if you like secret shops, you can get stat boosters near the endgame. Also, you can just buy him for 5k instead of 10k, or I guess kill him and steal his member card. Farina does have a case for not recruiting. She can be useful, like the rest of her counterparts, but if you're doing a ranked run, it's probably not best to spend 20,000 gold to get her, unless you know it won't affect your ranking, which would take a lot of skill and foresight to S rank funds despite losing 20 Gs. Renok is an easy yes, because he's kind of free anyway. Volk is basically free in Path of Radiance, and in Radiant Dawn, 3,000 gold is basically nothing. Shura, yes, probably you should go for it, unless you want move permanently on someone else, and that's actually gonna wrap things up for this video. Thank you so much for watching this video on basically the Beowulf archetypes. It would mean a lot if you left a like and commented down below your thoughts, whether it's about your experience with this archetype in your playthroughs, or the content of this video, or to simply help with a YouTube algorithm. Finally, if you haven't subscribed yet, and you're one of these folks on screen, please consider doing so, and I'll see you in the next one. Deuces.